Really?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. You're not putting it off anymore.
Why? Why?
Yeah, why? You know why. It's because you touch yourself at night. Also because people want to see this. Hear this. They don't want to see that.
They don't, what? Hello and welcome to another Space Doctory Minisode about Mass Effect Andromeda.
Wow, can you imagine like that? You're talking about Mass Effect and that level of, oh, I don't want to do this, like 6 months ago. you couldn't stop you talking about it back then.
Yeah,
now
I
it's kicking and screaming. I went to throw Pete in the bloody Jeffrey's tube and he was already hiding there.
Yeah, I know. And if he hadn't been hiding there, I bloody well would be. And you'd be doing this with him.
oh please, yeah, how would that be? It's a prawn.
Well, yeah, I suppose, but then, you know,
to be fair, that'll probably be better than this is going to end up being, but still.
Well, we can work this through. Yeah, so hello everyone, welcome to another Mass Effect minisode.
Okay, massisode, if you will. No,
yes, andromisode.
andromisode, I like that.
There you go.
I like that. There you go.
On the fly production meetings. That's what we love. So, yes. So basically.
You know what we should do? We should have a conference around the table at the back.
Oh, no. Stand around awkwardly looking at each other with boggle eyes, trying to make witty fucking Firefly style quips written by
that does pretty much sum up most of our minisodes.
Yeah. But enough of the minisodes. Let's move on to Andromeda. Oh, dear. Well, yes. So we are doing another Mass Effect minisode. The reason being is, as Andy explained to me behind the scenes, basically, we did the run-up, which was the trailer, and being all excited. And that was November the 7th, wasn't it, when we did
it
that?
It was, N7 Day. Halcyon days back then.
When the sky was blue.
Wild speculation about the Tempest, the name of the ship. What's going on here? Beautiful. We were so young, innocent.
Naive.
Yes.
Anyway, and then the game came out, and we had first impressions, which I wasn't very impressed with, but you
there were concerns
but you knew that you weren't going to be playing this game for another sort of 3 months or so.
Through at the time seemed terrible planning, but turned out quite fortuitous. I was going away for a while. I was off for a month.
Yes.
So the game landed and I could play it for about 4 days before I had to fly out. So yeah, that was at the time quite devastating. It was like, no!
But as it turned out.
But as it would turn out, probably not so much. Yeah. Quite fortuitous. Even.
Imagine if you've been like one of those super geeks that has sort of like cancelled all your plans to play it. And then,
well, yeah, that would have been.
Then you would know my pain.
if I'd taken a whole week off work just to play it.
Yeah, yeah. If only you'd been sad enough to take a whole week off. Just to sit there and play the game and be... Yeah, anyway. So we had the first impressions. I wasn't terribly impressed. Andy hadn't got a chance to play it.
We'd played about the same amount at that point.
Yes.
And we were both kind of a bit... We're early into the game. We've got to give it a chance, you know. That was generally the feeling.
Yes.
I don't think either of us had really come across any massive... bugs at that point, because in the immortal words of Bane, that come later.
You didn't have the bugs. I was born in the
bugs. Born by them, raised by them. I didn't see a piece of walking animation till I was already a man.
So here we are.
So that was all the way back in April, that was.
That was all the way back in April, and here we are, only 2 months down the line. It does feel like longer, I'll be honest with you.
It does, doesn't it?
But, So here we are, 2 months later, and, well, I abandoned the game, and you completed the game.
Yes, rage quit, flipped the desk, I think threatened to throw the disc out into the road to join Star Trek V, but then realised you could sell it for money.
Yes, it's the only thing that saved it.
And I got back from my travels and my gallivanting, and actually even then I didn't get straight back to it, but I got back to playing the game after it had been out for about a month or two, and then I finished it.
Yes. So, I mean, given that my dislike of this game is quite well known, I mean, I think it's probably in the interest of balance, probably a good idea for you to just give us your thoughts then. Go on, how you found it in the end and how it went through. And of course, talking about this game, if you haven't played it yet and you still intend to, spoilers ahoy and all.
This first bit, we'll just give you some initial impressions without spoiling anything. We will tell Mother to auto-destruct before it comes to the point of actually talking spoilers. But very briefly, the game is flawed. But it was less flawed by the time I got around to it than it was when it first arrived. There was a lot of, in some instances, game-crippling bugs. As it happened, by the time I sat down and properly got play into it, the only bug that was like there throughout wasn't game-crippling. It was just one of those... If you're a completionist like me, it was slightly irritating, but it was in no way the end of the world. Also, a lot of the animation issues and like the haunted look on the faces of some people, especially that director Addison, had been fixed for certainly a whole lot better than anything else that was there. But yeah, all in all, I enjoyed the game in so much as it held my attention. I went through, I played it to 97% completion. The only things I haven't done are a couple of the fetch quests, which I was like, yeah, I can't be asked for those.
But that's like 90% of the game, isn't it?
What, sorry?
That's about 90% of the game, fetch quests.
No, it's not. Nope.
I'm just going to step back again. Back into the shadows.
Trolley, trolley, trolley. Trollololololololololololol. So yeah, it was... I think I mentioned this at the time. I mean, I would put this... I think it's a mistake to try and compare this to Mass Effect 2 and 3, because Mass Effect 2 and 3 are continuing a story that was set up in Mass Effect 1. I feel that if you compare this game just to Mass Effect 1, I think while Mass Effect 1 had a more compelling story in the way that it was done together, I think this is, in every other respect, a better game. Now, this is a game where story is a big part of it, so... That is a big issue, but I'm very upset. It seems unlikely we will get a follow-up to this for a while, if at all. I mean, I'm sure they're not going to abandon Mass Effect full stop just because this one didn't get the best reviews. I mean, God knows it doesn't stop Michael Bay and all that. But I still think that this is a fundamentally a better game than Mass Effect 1.
Mechanically.
In terms of gameplay and mechanically and combat-wise and in those aspects. I just don't think the story was as compelling. But the problem I have is it's very hard for me to remember the Mass Effect 1 story without knowing what came next. So I'm trying to just take it as the story as it presented at the beginning.
Yeah. I take your point. And the one thing I would say, though, is even Mass Effect, just to add some balance in, Mass Effect really didn't kick in until you go to the... once you completed those first like key worlds.
Once you got on off Eden Prime and you go to the Theros Citadel and you got all of that stuff. Yeah. And then you get... Really, it doesn't kick in until maybe the second or third planet. So be it, is it Novaria Prime or...
Yeah, there's Novaria, there's Theros, and then there's... Oh, God, what's the last one? Vermeer.
Lohmeyer, yeah. Hmm. It really doesn't kick off until you've been to maybe two of those and, you know, stuff starts coming together then. But even that, I mean, the end of a game, it's compelling. The characters in the original Mass Effect, for the most part, were far better written. I mean, I still have it. This is a funny thing. I have issues with the human characters in both Mass Effect 1 and in Andromeda. But to the point of with Andromeda, I would quite happily throw them all out of a fucking airlock.
Yeah, I wouldn't let them on the ship, but there you go.
Yeah, no. But yeah, so yeah, like I said, I do not think this game was worthy of the vitriol it received online. Mm-hmm. It had problems, absolutely. And yeah, I mean, they shouldn't have released a game as buggy as it was. But unfortunately, we're just living in an industry and in a world now where that's what happens. You know, they have to hit a release date, come hell or high water, which is why I hate them setting release dates and sticking to it no matter what. But
that's not really an excuse. I mean, you know, the thing is, I mean, memes aside, I mean, we got to just ignore those stupid memes, because the thing was, the memes got addressed in like the first patch. So just ignore all that kind of walking like a wonky gorilla that shits.
Oh, but walking itself. Like a wonky, but there was still plenty of bugs there. I mean, yeah, I think it was after the second patch when you rage quit, when it was because Sam wouldn't shut up about you having an email, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, basically, the reason I rage quit was because, firstly, one of the actual story missions was broken because the person I was supposed to meet had suddenly teleported 17 miles underground. And then when I went down into caves and everything to get to them, it turned out that they then teleported again to the position they were supposed to be at, but they were no longer marked on the map. So you had to then go and actually walk out into like frozen tundra, which basically would kill you if you were out for too long. And you had to then find this person without a marker, only to find that they'd been teleported inside the leg of a spaceship.
As you do.
So there was no way of actually activating the story. So I thought, well, fuck this. This is the end of the game for me because I can't even carry the game on. Then they brought out a patch. The guy had been moved like 2 feet to the left and had a marker in the map. And then after seeing him, I went back to the Tempest. And every time I walked through the door, it went, Pathfinder, you have a new email. And it's like, right, okay, fine. So I go over to the email console. Nothing. So I go through a door, Pathfinder, you have a new email. It's like, right, okay, so I go back to the console, nothing. And it turned out that every time you did an interaction, whether you talked to someone, walked through a door, climbed up a ladder, looked at your inventory, as soon as the game registered a change in state, it would tell you that you had an email. And it literally took me like 20 minutes of walking around the Tempest of, Pathfinder, you have an email. Pathfinder, you have an email. Pathfinder, you have a new email. New email at your console, Pathfinder. Pathfinder, you have an email. It's like, fucking shut up. And yeah, and then another mission just bugged, and then that was it. I was just like, I've had enough of this. I just can't take it anymore.
No, I get that, and that's absolutely fair enough. But by the time I got to the game to play it, I don't know how many patches have been released at that point and what have you, but I didn't encounter any of those bugs. And the point I was making is, it's just a state of the industry these days where they release a game and then you've got day one, like multiple gigabyte patches to fix the bugs which they knew about when they sent the game out. And that's just a criticism of the industry.
Yeah, which is fine, and I get that. But my point is that, you know, saying that Mass Effect Andromeda is mechanically better than Mass Effect 1 isn't a major step up when you consider that there's been nearly a decade between the two. But the writing's got worse.
So it's like... No. To be fair, though, again, there were multiple instances of games which, you know, came out a long time ago, and games which come out today are utter guff. And that's just... You're right, the combat system's a lot better, but again, it's not... I mean, I've not played the Dragon Age games, but you've told me that it seems like Bioware, every game is the previous game with some tweaks to it.
Yes, that's essentially how it works. Yeah,
so it's that sort of thing. But yeah, I mean, at the very least, the way people were talking about this game online, you'd think this was like, you know, are there with the ET game on the Atari, you know?
Okay, yeah. I mean, that's fair enough. I mean, it's always the thing with the internet, though, isn't it? It's the state of overreaction because of anticipation. So you kind of have to you have to take all of that stuff with a pinch of salt. I mean, if I was to give it a rating out of 10, I'd say it was a 5. But in the terms of it, in terms of with the Mass Effect, within the Mass Effect universe, it's the same as Phantom Menace. Insofar as Phantom Menace, in and of itself, is not a terrible film. It's just a boring one. But then when you compare it to the three Star Wars that came before it, you go, that's a pile of shit.
I get the point you're trying to make, but I take issue with you saying that Phantom Menace is a fine film, albeit boring.
I'm not saying it's a fine film. I'm just saying it's a mediocre film. It's just a film that if it was on a Saturday afternoon, people wouldn't go, oh, wow, it's there. And nor would, if it wasn't related to Star Wars, would sit there and go, that's
crap. Yeah, but I think Andromeda on its own is an entertaining, a fun game. I enjoyed it. I played it all the way through. And, you know, one of the reasons why I was able to enjoy it, I think, was because I was able to disseminate the connection to Mass Effect, which got a bit difficult later on because they started to ham fist some bits and pieces in there. But we'll get to that in a second with the spoilery stuff. I mean, I would say, just to be awkward, I'll give it a rating out of alphabet rather than numbers. So I'll give it a... I think I'd give it a low B. Not quite a B minus, but I'd give it a B.
And
a
just
B out of 10.
And just for context.
For context, I would give Mass Effect 1... I'd probably give Mass Effect 1 the same. I'd give Mass Effect 2 and 3, though, an A triple plus, gold star, go to the front of the class. In fact, take your homework, show it to the principal as an example of good work.
Right, okay. Because for me, I would say that with... In terms of you know, it relating to A's to Z's or whatever it was, I would give Andromeda a C, just because it's just, if you took the Mass Effect trappings away from it, you just end up with a kind of fairly humdrum run around explorathon, and you know, with a bit of gunning, and the text and the dialogue and the conversations and the story are pretty generic. It's only when you compare it into the Mass Effect universe and you suddenly go, well, I expect more at this point.
Mm. No, that's a fair point. I take your point. I just, again, I didn't have an issue with any of that sort of thing. I actually found some of the character development stuff later on much more compelling than it had been for the first half of the game. It was almost like the stuff towards the second half had more time spent onto it. And a lot of the stuff up at the front end was felt more rushed, more like we just need to get to this stuff. So... blah, 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 blah. Okay, here we go. And you can get on with it there. But yeah, I mean, I think that'll do for the non-spoilery sex stuff for people.
Yep.
So yeah. Look, I think if you like Mass Effect, as in a game series as a whole, now that most of the bugs are fixed, that I can tell, I'd definitely say it's worth giving a go, especially since it's not whatever it was, £50 when it came out. You know, go pick it up. It's cheap from... where did you say yours to? Computer Game Exchange? Yeah, I'm sure you can find his copy still sitting on the shelves.
Yeah, well, actually, it's quite telling. I went into a game last week, and in game, there was about 400 copies of it all on the shelves under the used. They didn't actually have any full price copies anymore.
Well, there you go. Go and pick yourself up a nice cheap copy from game. I put in 85 hours into it, and I enjoyed it all. So,
Yeah, I put 40 in before I bailed out, so I gave it. It wasn't like I didn't give it a spin. didn't give it a chance. I think 40 hours solid play was pretty much, all I was willing to give it after a while.
Yeah, it's true. But given how buggy and everything it was up until that point, it was a bit like, you know, drinking 40 gallons of sour milk rather than waiting for some pasteurized stuff to come out.
Yeah, exactly. I'm gonna drink some full fat that's been out in the sun.
Yeah.
Or I can wait for 6 weeks until someone comes along with a
until the milkman comes with a fresh delivery.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay then. Well, should we move on to the spoilery stuff for what it's worth?
I don't think it's been massively spoilery, but we're just going to talk more general stuff about the story and what we did like, what we didn't like, and more particulars there. So, yes, at the sound of a beep, you may listen again.
At the sound of the collector master.
Oh, okay, yes.
Assuming direct control.
I am assuming direct control.
Right, okay, so here we are on the other side of the collector.
Yes.
Yes.
Just yes.
Yes. Okay, so can I ask a quick question? So can I get right in there right away?
Go on, get in there.
Can I just do this, right?
Do the thing.
The geezer with the ring pool on his head, who's the Archon. Yes.
Yes.
Was he a good villain, or was he, as I suspected after 40 hours, nothing more than basically a jumped up businessman working for someone else?
It's certainly, the story is he's working for someone else, but you know, you don't even get a sense or a hint about anything. I mean, I'd put him up there with, it's kind of like Harbinger if he didn't have everything around him. And I don't mean Harbinger the Reaper, I mean Harbinger the Bug.
Yeah, the collector. You know, just
the collector bug sort of thing. He's just a bigger version of the thing. Yeah, he's a middle manager. Again, the villain in this wasn't particularly compelling. And I think that was, again, let's be clear, I make no bones about it. There are story issues in this. It is the biggest problem with this game is the story. I don't think they needed a big bad like that in this game at all. I think it would have been far more compelling if it was more of just a story about them trying to set up their home in Andromeda and lots of that sort of stuff. I mean, that is the story. You're fighting against the sector itself, not Collector Knockoff 2.0. And they literally are the collectors. I mean, straight up.
Mm. Yeah.
They literally, you know, so the Ket, they effectively assimilate species they encounter and turn them into new Ket.
Yeah, that was kind of just about where I got to, I think. Yeah. I found the Ket, the first Ket base, and rescued the what was it? The Angaran lady.
The mushy mushy.
Yeah. And it was like soon as I did that, I was like, oh, okay. So that's exactly what I thought. Collectors 2.0.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, they were collectors, and I think that was a problem in that they were. They were too similar to the collectors. I mean, I think it would have been far more compelling if either there was no singular big bad. It was just against the sector of space and just a challenge of that of its own. Mm. Or if they played out the rebellion thing a bit further and you got a sense of, you know, they're fighting among themselves, you know, they're taking a bit of a backward step there, perhaps. And, you know, you've got raiding parties and stuff like that. Like you have to occasionally run back to the... what do you call the fucking thing? The Nexus, because there's a raiding party there stealing all your shit, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
That sort of stuff.
Yeah, just sort of more of a colonization site kind of thing, ready to establish the world to set everything up.
Exactly. I think it would have been much better served if they did something along those sort of lines. Again, you know, they just fell into this trap that you need a big bad there. And again, you know, you could hint at something coming for the next game or something like that would be better. Mm. But yeah, the cat as they were pretty weak source.
Yeah, I mean...
And also, I'll just point out, by not even halfway through, my character and my team were so grossly overpowered, we were now unstoppable. You know, I mean, the big scary things which could meet you on the battlefield were those... I can't remember what they're called, but they kind of float above with a circle, your orb, and they got a shield and everything like that.
Yeah.
And the first time I meet them, I was like, oh, shit. But the next time I see them, I've got a Valkyrie gun, which... launches grenades of plasma, which when they land just incinerate anything around those. It's like I empty a clip of those into them and anything is dead. It's just like, you're dead, you're dead, you're dead, everyone's dead.
Yeah, I mean, that was the other thing. I mean, it was that whole thing of it was so the open world side of things was just, I don't know, it was just the open world side of things was open to exploitation. I mean, I literally, at one point, when I was really bored and the story seemed to be going nowhere, I literally went to Habitat 7? The desert one, the one that you go to first.
Eos,
that's it. I went there, and after I'd sort of established all the bases, I just stood on a really tall rock out by the those kind of Ket, sort of Geiger-esque kind of wind farm things.
Yeah.
And if you stand on the rock, those big rhinos just keep spawning. So I just stood there and I just shot them to shit until I had like, I was up to like, I literally leapt about 12 levels just sitting there just kind of, there's another one. Bang, 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 bang. Let's go back, get some more ammo. come back. Bang, 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 bang. Oh, there they are, all dead again. Oh, we've all run out of ammo. Let's go again. Bang, 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 bang. And it was just boring. But it was. Well, but yeah, by that point, I literally just walked straight out into the middle of the Kep base by the end of that, and I was just like, all these Kep running at me, and I'm like, yeah, fuck off, flick.
Well, I certainly didn't decide to just stand on top of a hill for a better part of a day just shooting rhinos.
That was purely my decision after about 30 hours of play. It was like,
The planets, I enjoyed them all except for one. There was one planet which can literally go die in a fire because it was boring as shit. They had this jungle world. Havel or something like that. Havai. Yeah. I can't remember. It's the Angara homeworld, effectively.
Haval.
And oh, God. I mean, because it's so densely packed with foliage, you can't bring out the nomad. And in addition to that, it's just. It's so small, it's so samey, it's dark, it's just a miserable place to be on it. So yeah, as soon as I'd done all the missions on that planet, I was like, yeah, fuck this place, I ain't never coming back. And I was just, I was gone from there. Yep. But I really enjoyed, I liked Eos. Eos kind of had a Red Dead Redemption vibe to me, just like you said, when you're standing on those rocks. I mean, say what you will about the Frostbite engine, and we will say a lot, it is gorgeous for doing those sort of landscapes.
Yeah.
And that was great. Although I was a bit disappointed. At one point, I thought they were going to get some sort of weather generation or at least like a day-night cycle. But no, there wasn't. No. The ice planet, once you've cured it, it's quite a nice place because you get rid of all the storms and everything.
That was another planet full of broken missions.
Well, by the time I got to it, they were all fixed. So yeah. your mileage will may vary there.
Yeah. I was just going to say, you know, the base, it's right in the middle. There's like a massive mountain pass base.
Yeah.
That you're supposed to go in there and you're supposed to fight your way to the top and find, I can't even remember what you're supposed to find now, but you're supposed to, I think it was an Angaran like warrior or something, or a rebel leader or something.
Oh yeah, I know. Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah, well, I found him and the mission failed. The mission failed to...
Mission mailed.
No. It never sort of like registered as complete.
Yeah, yeah. Fish and mailed. It's a joke going back to Metal Gear Solid 2.
Yeah, fish and mailed. Yeah, it just the mission was always there forever, uncompleted. Yeah. It was like, oh, great. And then it was always turning up on my map whenever I landed. You know, it was just, oh, fuck off. I've already done it.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah. Sorry, carry on. I'm going to keep having these flashbacks.
No, absolutely. Flashback as you like, as you're going along. So yeah, I'm just trying to remember what the other planets were. There's Io, which is, it's not really a planet. That's more of just another citadel type base. That's the one where they have their thing, the Angara have their markets and all that sort of stuff, you know, which is just a bit meh. What's the one? It began with a K. The one with the pirate base on.
On with all the acid. Yeah, it's the acid.
Yeah, the acid
planet.
Baths and everything on that
the
one. Yeah.
Acid I mean, that was part of it. I think that was part of my eye rolling moment. It's like we've got the desert planet, then we've got the ice planet. And then we have the dry planet, and then we have the acid planet.
It's the big Star Wars book of terraforming, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
Each planet is just made up of a single ecosystem.
Yeah. Oh boy. Yeah. That. Oh god. Yeah. I'm trying to think what that bloody planet was called now. But anyway, carry on.
So yeah. Again, you got some colourful characters there. In the town bit of that, you know, which is kind of more of that kind of backwater, moss, icy sort of vibe they were going for there. Mm. But again, you know, you just feel like, given that it is, 10 years now since Mass Effect 1?
Yep.
You expected it to be bigger and more. And from what I've gathered, from what I've read about the development of this game, and there's an interesting article on, was it IO9?
Kotaku.
Which I'm sure we'll link to something in here, but you can see they started off very ambitious, wanting to make it kind of like hundreds and hundreds of worlds which you could explore and settle. And then it got reduced down to 85, and then it was reduced down to half a dozen, and then it was, what, six in the end, I think it is.
Yeah, yeah.
And, yeah, you just get the sense that they choked on their aspirations.
Yeah.
It was a bit much there. But that being said, the planets you get to go to, I mean, they're pretty enough to walk around. They're not all that. They're just a bit, yeah, there you go. When I land there, you know, I go around, I drop my remote beacon things, whatever they're called, I can't remember. Forward deployment stations things. And then I just go around and I just, you know, I go to each icon in turn and go, do that, do that, do that, do that, do that. Planet's clean. Right, next one. And I just production line it.
Yeah, there are resources you can harvest, Pathfinder. Shut the fuck up.
No, I fucked up. Fuck off. As soon as I spec'd out like tier 7 N7 armor for my guy. And about, I was basically playing as myself. As soon as I got that done, I was like, well, I'm good. I don't need any more resources. I'm good.
Yeah. Yeah. But it was just, again, it was that whole thing of, I'm driving around. There are new resources for you here, Pathfinder. Fuck off. Stop telling me every time I drive around in a circle, you've just drove over the same bit that we just spoke.
I mean, I'd be more inclined to do the resourcing thing if it wasn't such a ball ache just trying to get them all, because you know they're in this area, but it doesn't tell you where. Are you just driving backwards and forwards, like combing it, trying to just find the peak bit on the graph so you can drop your probe?
That's it. Yep. Oh, man. Yeah. I mean, that brings me to my next thing. I mean,
Kadara, that was the name of that planet.
Kadara. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. But it's like, did you feel that a lot of those kind of transitions and all those planets and everything were just a complete waste of time? Not the ones you landed on, but the...
Do you mean the animation where you've got to go from the camera slowly moves and then it accelerates and it goes into the warp thing and then it slows down and then it gives you this nice little thing. Yeah, that was annoying as fuck. But again, by the time I got to play the game properly, I could skip those.
Yeah.
Because at first I couldn't skip them. But by the time I got into it properly, you could just press X and skip all those animations.
Yeah. I mean, there's the other thing was also... No, but I'm talking about things like take for example, the most maligned of things from Mass Effect 2, the mining.
Yeah.
Now, there's something to be said for that. You can sort of like go in and there's a little exploration element in terms of just like flicking between planets and going, is there any resources here? Have a little scan around. Oh, look, there's some resources there. I need some. Scan, 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 scan. And you can do as much as little as that as you like. But in terms of Andromeda, you burn into the actual solar system. And the first thing that happens is the lady, the Scottish lady, Suvi, goes, oh, there's something over there, Pathfinder. And you go, right, okay, you scan it. And you're not even like near the planet. You've just scanned from a distance and gone, oh, right, so that's the only planet I need to go to. Fly straight to that. And then you can fly to the other planets, but there's nothing there. It's literally just a ball that you animate.
You sometimes find, oh, there's a satellite in orbit or there's a ship in orbit or something like that. But yeah, there's nothing worthwhile in that respect. And yeah, I mean, that is a bit tedious. Again, that sort of side of it.
It was more just the fact that it kind of, that for something that's supposed to feel quite so expansive, it actually felt more restricted because you didn't feel the need to go to the other planets. Uh-huh. Especially after like the first time when I went to like Habitat 7, you see Habitat 7 and there's all those other planets around and you hop to each and every one of them and there's not even like the ability to scan. It's just like, oh, so what am I doing? This is just a screensaver. I'm just rolling a planet around with my thumbstick. And it's like, after that, it's like, oh, right, okay, so now what? Fine, I won't bother going to these planets again. And after like the second solar system, when it's like Pathfinder, the stuff's over there, it's like, oh, right, okay, well, I'll go over there then. Scan that planet. Oh, look, there is something there, so I don't need to go to any of these other planets. No, fine, right. So suddenly, what looked like a 60 odd planets that you could have explored, actually, there was only two, and it expressly points them out to you so you don't waste your time going to the other 60.
Well, yeah, that is nice of them to make that bit of easier for you. There were still instances where you'd go into orbit of a planet and it would find something else, though. Because, I'm one of those who I rock into a system and, you got the little counter over the top which says how explored it is, and that had to be 100% before I'd leave the system. So I'm nowhere near as bad as my mate Brian, who proudly declared that in Mass Effect 2 he was the proud captain of a mining vessel, SSV Normandy, because he would mine every planet in the entire system. I mean, he's why there's no resources in Mass Effect 3. He cleaned that fucker out.
Yeah, well, that's cool. But but again, that's the whole point, isn't it? Every planet in Mass Effect 2 and 3, you could still go to, scan, and find something, even if it was just resources, even if it was just seeing that there was little...
In Andromeda, every system, as well as the one, you know, when you arrive, she'll say, oh, something on scanner, it's fine. But if you then go and scan the planets as well, at least one or two of them will have something in addition. It's usually... there'll be like resources on the planet, or there'll be like a geographical feature, like a volcano or something on there, or there's a satellite in orbit that you can scan. So there is still that there if you go and look for it. It's not like you won't find anything if you scan these planets. There is stuff out there.
Okay, fair enough. But, well, again, I never got that impression after 40 hours. But again, you know, I mean, I didn't stick around for patch 7. Or patch 8 or whatever it was by the time...
Whichever one it was. But anyway, yeah. So in my experience, anyway, there was stuff to do in that regard. So yeah, there's that.
What about the
Nexus? The Nexus, which really is just the Citadel.
Citadel.
By another word.
Yeah, I was going to say small Citadel. Tiny Citadel.
I will call it mini Citadel.
Yes. Yes. Little Citadel. Little Citadel.
Kind of disappointing in that it was no different from the Citadel, and again, you just don't. Again, you'd think, given 10 years later, given the stuff you can do with this, I was hoping for a bigger environment, or at least more of them you can explore. But in actuality, there's only two places on the Nexus you can explore: the docking bay and the ops center. Everything else is still on the Ark.
Yeah, and even then, it's like once you've done the three little pickup missions from each of those places, there's never a need to go back to them.
No, there's still stuff to go back to do that I found. There's little missions and stuff which take you down there in places. Like with ops and everything like that, you know, there's multiple missions for the people in there. And once they've patched the living mannequin that was Director Addison, it's no longer terrifying to go and speak to her. So... that's good. Plus, Drax always hanging out in ops, and it's always fun chatting to him. But then you've got... the Cryo Bay was the one where you really had no reason to go back to, except for the two instances where you get a message from a doctor saying, hey, do you want to come and see your sister? Not really, but okay. Yeah. Or your brother, as the case may be, depending on which way you went. The Cryo Bay was just like, yeah, there's no sense in coming back here. But going back onto the Nexus and the SAM node and all that sort of thing, again, it's really more you go there for mission reasons than there's anything worth just going to explore. You know, it's just you'll be told when you need to be there, basically.
Exactly. Which, again, that kind of it makes it feel, even though it's a bigger game, it makes it feel more confined, because in the whole thing with like something like Mass Effect 1, for example, you could be running around the Citadel and then run into a guy who just wants to, I don't know, hack the fruit machines, or, you know, wants to scan the keepers.
Oh no, there's still that in the docking bay and in the ops center. It's just not so much on those two bits on the Ark. I mean, there is a mission you pick up there, but I don't think. Yeah, I think you get emailed and told you have to go and do that one. But there is still that whole walking around. You know, someone will shout out Pathfinder, and then you go what?
Yeah,
oi. Go over there. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, Pathfinder. So, yeah, there is still that stuff in there and bits and pieces there. And a little bit as well on the planets as well, to a certain extent, you know, when you're going along and you just kind of see someone shouting you, then it's like, what do you want?
Yeah. But it's that the problem I had with a lot of it, though, was also the fact that despite them trying to distance themselves from Mass Effect, you know, the main story, the amount of times it tried to shoehorn in elements which, with your own foreknowledge of the universe, you would have reacted in a completely different way. It's that whole thing of like, I don't know if you found it, but on that acid planet,
yeah,
there's a little base sort of stuck right out in the distance somewhere, and there's two
Overlord stuff.
Yeah, and there's the stuff from Overlord.
There's a whole thing about Overlord beyond that.
Yeah. No, but that's what I'm saying. It's just like there's the Overlord sort of spin-off stuff, and then you find out that there's Cerberus people, and yeah. It's like, hang on, you know, knowing what I know about Cerberus, shouldn't I be kicking your ass all over the place? And knowing what I know about Overlord, because you know, this isn't just I'm not telling you what it is. This is for newbies. This is clearly for the fans who have bought the DLC. It's not even in like the main story, and yeah. It's like. So if you're going to include that stuff, then give us a bit more context than just Ryder standing there going, Cerberus, who are they? It's like, we know who you fucking are.
I mean, you know who we are. But I think you and I came across that mission before we were meant to come across it. Or rather, there's another sub... So there's another mission where this group try and destroy your AI, Sam. Because they're against AIs and stuff like that.
Yes.
And it works out that the woman running it, her kid was one of the prototypes for the Overlord, who's there as well. So there's a whole other set of submissions linking into Overlord. And I think if you came to those guys after doing that mission, you might have different options.
Wow. Okay, so that's...
Well, I'm just saying contextually, yeah. But again, you know about Cerberus, you, Lee Medcalf, know about them, and the player does. But Ryder doesn't know about them because he's an idiot.
Yes. Yes, he is. Very, very much so.
Well, I'll tell you what. Let's get to what is probably the biggest elephant in the room, Elkor in the room. It's the biggest Elkor in the room problem with this game. It's going to come down to the characters. I mean, that's what we love about Mass Effect, the original trilogy. It's the characters. It's the story. It's Shepard. It's Rex. It's Garrus. It's not Ashley because fuck the space Nazi, but it's the rest of them.
Well, you say that, but my last playthrough, I actually romanced Ashley, and you know what? I found that she's the only character that has the biggest arc in terms of all the other characters. It was quite surprising, actually.
Hmm.
But anyway.
But yeah, the characters, it honestly feels to me like they had two teams writing characters. You had a team writing the alien characters and a team writing the human characters. And the ones writing the alien characters had at least heard of Mass Effect. And the ones writing the human characters are all assholes.
Yeah. I just... The human characters all sounded like someone's first attempt at trying to write Firefly.
All of the human crew pissed me off. But the one who pisses me off the most is Liam. Liam just annoys the fuck out of me. I don't know if it's his faux British accent. It's just... his general appearance, the way he is. I mean, the whole thing of him having a bloody couch that he's somehow managed to bring over to the Andromeda Galaxy and all that sort of stuff.
Oh, God.
He's forever sticking his nose in with unsolicited opinions. He's self-righteous. He's judgmental. He's just, you know, you say, hey, Liam, how you doing? When I was with Crisis back in, they say, oh, fuck off, man. No one asked you anything. Just piss off. But the worst thing with Liam is, he legitimately fucks up at one point. I mean, he does something. Yeah. He passes confidential information to an Angaran who is later captured.
Right.
And, you know, it could blow the entire show. He legitimately fucks up and you have to go and clean up this mess. And there is no option there to kick him the fuck off your ship at the end of that.
So
now, if you recall back to Mass Effect 3, you have that reporter. She says something you don't like, you can kick her off your ship.
Yep.
Why can't I do the same with Liam? I want him gone. Piss off.
I mean, well, that kind of goes back to the whole thing of what I was saying before about the whole thing being fairly limited in terms of, you know, it
really is limited. It's one of those things where you'd kind of hope, and it was certainly sold in this sense that it would be, you could do pretty much anything. But I mean, by and large, all of the human crew on the Tempest just annoyed the hell out of me. You had Suvi, who, you know, look, I'm all for people who have faith and stuff like that. Fully respect. Hell, the third member who's currently tied up in a Jeffrey's tube, and it has just occurred to me that we might not have put holes in the box this time, but we'll deal with that later. But still, yeah, he's a man of a cloth. So honestly, we're fine with that. But she, at the drop of any hat, would start spouting off. I mean, it was like a Jehovah's Witness, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It's literally go, hey, Subi, how you doing? Do you ever just look at sky and just think, how did God paint the stars? And it's like, so you don't want coffee then? It was like that. And then you have Cora. Was it Cora?
Yes.
Little Miss. I wanted to be the Pathfinder. I should have been the Pathfinder. I was going to be the Pathfinder. Why aren't I the Pathfinder?
Yeah. Cora Harper, it might be worth mentioning. But, yeah.
And then you had, was it Gil? Gilver. Oh, no, I'm not gay. I'm just super into you.
Yeah. Yeah, let's go and play. Let's go and play. What's it? Let's go and play poker.
Yeah.
Let's go and play poker, and then when I win, I will constantly remind you of it. It's just like, oh, fuck off.
Yeah. This was no, you know, kind of Shepard and Garrus shooting cans on the top of a citadel.
No, I would have pushed him off the bloody roof, and shot him on the way down.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that being said, the alien characters I didn't really have a problem with. I think Drac is my second favourite Krogan in all of Mass Effect, just edging out Grunt, I've got to say. You know, he's just like angry war granddad. And some of the dialogue when you're driving around over Nomad with him is just hilarious. I didn't mind, I can't remember his name, Pilot. The Salarian chap.
Oh.
No, sorry, it's just my phone. Ignore that.
Ignore that.
But yeah.
Yeah, well, it doesn't it say something, though, that we can't...
remember their names. Yeah.
I can't. I played for 40 hours. You played it right through to the end and did 80 hours, and you can't remember their names.
In my defense, I still don't remember your name half the time.
Well,
I've got a little biro drawing on my hand saying Beard Lee, No Beard Darren. It gets very confusing with you and Pete.
Tall Lee, short Pete.
Yeah. Oh, that's a good one. I'll just add that underneath there. There you go.
Yeah, just put that in brackets.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I think what Andromeda lacks in terms of storytelling and characters is subtlety. That's the thing that kind of got me. I mean, I mentioned it in the last podcast when we did this, which was like that whole thing of, and you just brought it up again, the fact that you can't have a conversation with everyone without everyone just spilling their life story without you even inquiring.
Mm.
And it's just that, I mean, as I said before, there was that character who basically got on the Andromeda mission to literally get away from her original birth name, which was, you know, a male gendered name. And she wanted to be she, and she wanted to go somewhere else because her family wouldn't understand and all this sort of thing. And you're like, right, okay, cool. But in the actual conversation, within two clicks, she's told you her original name that she ran away from. So
I mean, that led to a bit of controversy. But I mean, again, I mean, one of the things is, you know, in Mass Effect, the original trilogy and all that, you know, you had to unlock certain dialogue choices by asking questions and stuff like this. No, this time around, there's straight up a little button that goes, I'm interested in you. Yeah. It's just like, wow, man, we ain't wasting no time here, are we? It's just, there you go.
No, I mean, I think...
Intergalactic space slut, you rock on, Alex Rider.
Yeah, I mean, it was quite funny. It was quite funny because I didn't even realise what was going on with the icons on the chat the first time round. And it's like I literally walked onto the bridge of the Tempest, and the first thing I did was saw Suvi, and I only know her name because you've just reminded me. Literally walked up to Suvi, and I thought, well, the interesting conversations, the way the dialogue chats tend to work, is if you go left, it opens up and branches out. But I went left, and it opened up and branched out into, hey, how you doing? It's like I literally had only been on the ship for less than 10 seconds, and she's like... Yes, well, that's lovely, but I'm not really into gentlemen. It's like, oh, what? I didn't mean that. I was just trying to find out. I was just trying to do the dialogue thing. And that's the thing. And then those choices that you make, they're all there. And you suddenly go, right, okay, I'll pick this choice, pick that choice, pick that choice. But really, all you do is you get a response to that choice. And then they go back to their already pre-recorded dialogue. So they were going to say whatever they were going to say anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes no difference. The dialogue was just like something that was something tacked on the front of their already pre-scripted scene.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of like the idea that it was no longer a black and white Paragon Renegade, light side, dark side, kind of binary choice with your conversations. There was no bright red one is the bad response, bright blue one is the good response. But as a result of that, like you said, none of your results really mattered.
No.
You ended up at the same point each time. There was no way you could have a evil bastard shepherd, you know, who punches the guy out of a window with the scars and all that. You know, you never get a sense that that was going to come around. So, yeah, that was all a bit...
But it was also the whole thing of, like, you know, imagine a conversation that would be you talking to someone and you say, you use the logical answer to their question. You go, maybe if we move this box. And the person goes, yes, moving the box would be a good idea. Now, let me tell you about why I moved to Andromeda. And then just carries on with the prescripted scene. And if you suddenly go back and load that scene again and go to the sarcastic one, the sarcastic question, the sarcastic response, she go, what do you think we're going to move that box for, huh? And they go, and she goes, yes, moving that box would be a good idea. Anyway, let me tell you why I came to Andromeda. It's like, hold on. Nothing's changed at all. All you did was just pause for a tiny bit longer and my character had a different tone of voice. But the actual conversation was exactly the same.
Yeah. Yeah, a little bit, I mean that's kind of all we can do. I mean, the story overall is, if I could quote Immortan Joe, mediocre.
Yes.
No, it's just, you never really got a sense of urgency. I mean, I enjoyed the missions where you have to go and find the additional arcs, which got lost.
I never even got that far.
But those were quite fun missions. Finding the other Pathfinders, like the Turian one, the Salarian one, the Asari one, they were cool. And again, you know, they get brought back to the Nexus, and things change. You know, you got more of a certain, you know, you get more Asari appearing on the thing, and little background bits of conversation kind of spike up, which is kind of nice. There's some very heavy-handed nods to the original Mass Effect trilogy. Which were effectively little more than bloody diary recordings, and another message from Liara to Sony.
Well, was it Zaid Masani's illegitimate son out in the desert on the island?
No, I did find him, but I didn't put two and two together until you mentioned it.
it was like oh, it seemed like if it wasn't a diary entry, then it would be someone who knew someone who knew someone who knew Garrus.
Oh, or... at one point you had you know, those memory things from
that's right.
Sir not appearing in this movie, Clancy Brown.
Yes.
One of those is with Garrus's dad.
That's right.
Like literally, straight up Garrus's dad. It's just like,
well, yeah, yeah. Because he even says on the screen, he goes, "Yeah, I'll have to speak to my son. He works in CSEC. His name is Garrus."
He's like, yeah. Wink, yeah. Wink.
Yeah. Should I be using the other eye? Yeah.
It's like... I mean, what's kind of irritating as well is there's a couple of really interesting subplots which they don't actually follow through or go anywhere.
No.
There's this whole thing about the benefactor,
yep,
who sponsored this thing, which just kind of fizzles out. You know, we get no satisfaction there. The head of the thing, I can't remember what her name is, but the doctor who's responsible for it all is murdered.
Yeah,
and that doesn't really go anywhere.
Jin-Garson.
You know, so that's just a bit disappointing. There's the missing arc, which is bloody talk about you setting up for a sequel thing. There you go. We've just received a message from the other arc. Well, I guess we'll have to go and see what happens next time. You know, at the end there. So yeah, there's a lot of that sort of, you know, towards the end, which is just a bit. And again, I mean, the final mission is almost shot for shot taken from the end of Mass Effect 1. You know, it's the whole what was the planet with Virgil on? What was that called?
Vigil. Was Ilos.
Yeah, the very final mission is effectively Ilos. You're on the Nomad and you've got to race to the final bit before the final confrontation with the Archon and everything. And it's just like, just like on Ilos, it's just like, you know, plant your foot to the floor and just gun it.
Yeah, exactly. Don't wait. Just go. No.
And none of that sort of thing. And again, while that's happening, all of the characters you've interacted with or spoken to during the game will send you radio messages or little nods or something like that. And it's just like, well, whatever.
Yeah.
I don't really care at that point. But yeah, I mean, I've probably come across sounding more negative than I feel about the game when I finished it. I like I said, I legitimately enjoyed the game straight up, you know, and I'm a huge Mass Effect fan. I would say I'm as big a fan of Mass Effect as you are. I think that's fair to say. Well, I have many a ship on my thing, but I enjoyed the thing. So I think if anyone's looking at it, I think it's worth a go.
Whereas I don't know. I don't know if this marks me out as some kind of weird purist or something, but for me, it took one step forward and two steps back. It kind of undermined a lot of stuff from the originals that I didn't appreciate. Things like oh yes, the Tempest can just, you know, it doesn't need Mass Effect relays. What do we need them for?
Oh yeah, that you know, I mean, yeah, when that comes on the main episode, that's going to fuck everything up, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
Those bloody Odyssey engines.
Yeah, exactly. and then things like, oh, the Genophage. Oh, don't worry, the Krogan will just grow out of that.
No, straight up when that happened, go, well, I got better.
Exactly. It's like, oh, right, so you're just going to take 1,000 years of back history and just go, you know what? Being away from T'Chunka actually sort of solved our problems. Really? Oh, right. Okay, so why haven't we got, like, rampaging Krogan all around the universe now? It's just like, there were so many naff little moments like that that just undermined it. And I almost want to have someone, some modder, go back, take all the references to Mass Effect out, and just play the game as just another space adventure. Because,
well, I'd still quite like to do our experiment where we get someone who's never played Mass Effect games to play through of it.
Yeah, I don't think anyone will have a problem, because it loses some of the things like lifts and, you know, that kind of stuff.
The combat system is honestly the best we've seen in any Mass Effect game, frankly.
But the combat system again undermines a certain stuff with that kind of catch-all with bloody Sam. He's like, oh, I want to be an infiltrator today. Oh, I want to be a.
I never bothered with any of that shit. I was a what one is it? I'm the tech with soldier skills. Is that infiltrator?
Yeah.
I've got the shield. Yeah, I set up as that at the beginning, and that's it. I just stayed at that the entire game, through the game. Yeah. I can't be bothered with none of this stopping mid-fight to change my specs.
Mm. Well, the thing was, I did. I thought, well, if it's there, I at least got to try it out, because, you know, there's got to be something in it. And I specced up a really powerful adept. You know, mm-hmm. Literally, I barely shot off a bullet.
Were you a biotic god?
I was. I was a biotic god stumbling around. And I was throwing stuff all over the place and, you know, freezing people in place and then picking them up and throwing them over the horizon and all that kind of stuff. And it was really good fun. The thing was, you know, I would basically only use weapons when I was facing something with armor, like those rhinos on when I'm just standing on the rock, just clocking up XP. But but the thing was, it was like, then all of a sudden I thought, well, I'm attacking a Ket base. Let's do some switcheroo. And I had like a Vanguard set up so I could go storming in there with, like, you know, sort of like jumping in a Nova and sort of shockwaving everyone out of the way and blasting people at close range with shotguns and that kind of thing. And it was useful, but I suddenly thought, well, you know what? That's actually cheating. It felt like cheating, because it was literally a case of like, oh, I'm in a really sticky situation right now, and I've got to use my skills to get out of this. Oh, or I could just switch to a completely different player, effectively, and go, oh, actually, now I've got all the biotic skills I need. Ta-da! And I'm out. And it just, again, it was like whole thing of just wiping things out and just ignoring the implications of, you know, canon implications of, you know, we've banned AI. And by the time I finished having my go with it and just thought, you know what, fuck it. There was two AI on the bloody Nexus. There was Sam, and then there was this other thing that I found under the ice.
Oh, the Ingaran thing?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you want to talk about your... It's HK-47 without a sense of humour, that is. That's going to bite him in the arse in a future episode. Yeah. Oh, all of the other arcs have Sams as well.
Hmm. So it's like... I don't know. To me, it just, there was so much stuff that it did to undermine previously done history, previously done canon. And say what you like about Mass Effect 1, and, you know, like I say, it's a 10-year-old game, so I accept that there are limitations. But part of the R in RPG is role, as in role-playing, as in you're playing a part, you're getting immersed in the world, you're dealing with, you know, weaponry and armor and, you know, balancing of your skills and your sets and everything. And literally in this, it was just a case of like, well, I like that look of that armor. I'll have that one. I'll have a white one. And then all the other characters all just running around in the same stock model, no matter what you give them. And you don't give them anything. You just say, oh, yeah. It's just, and that's the thing. It felt like every single bit of Mass Effect they took along, and then they went, actually, we haven't got time to deal with that bit, so let's just get rid of that. You know, managing of your inventory. People didn't like that. Let's get rid of that. It's like, managing of your character's stats. Well, let's just reduce that down to a kind of 5-star rating thing. And it's just, everything just was just reduced down. And while I appreciated the fighting and everything, it could have been any
I think there was more inventory management and character statting and stuff than there was in 2 and 3. But then again, I think everyone acknowledges 2 and 3 were less RPGs and more third-person shooters, really.
Well, exactly.
Really good story.
Exactly.
But, hell, you know, I think the takeaway here is I enjoyed it. Lee didn't.
No.
So, and Pete's never going to play it, so we can't really give you a definitive one way over there. I'll ask you a question, though. So, yes. So, if at all, anywhere, where would you like to see it go next? Mass Effect. It doesn't have to be an Andromeda thing, but what would you like to see next?
If they were going to do another game,
yeah.
I mean, I would like to be back in the Milky Way, and I think if they're going to do an Andromeda one, which I think is slightly unlikely. I think my first thought is BioWare and EA are going to go for a quick buck and remaster Mass Effect up to whatever next gen.
Can I throw it all on a Frostbite engine?
Yeah, I reckon that's next. But if they were to do another game, if they were to do another thing, you can't go up against, you know, endless universe-eating gods again, obviously. But I do think that if you've got a universe that's established with established aliens and established lore and established everything else, then put a bloody story in that. I mean, some of the best DLC was standalone stories that had nothing to do with the Reaper War.
Mm-hmm.
And I would love to have characters return from the original trilogy. And I'm not just talking about the core soldiers and stuff that you had on board with you. I'm talking about, like, your kind of your shadow brokers and all the, you know, who was the lady who, we had, you know, the council and you know, spectres around Citadel, you know. I mean, you could...
The consort, is that what you were talking about?
Yeah. The General Vicarious and Vicarious, yeah. And, you know, and Bailey on the Citadel and, you know, all these other characters that they established throughout the whole thing, you know, Thane's son, you know, the survivors of Mass Effect 3, you could easily take any one of them and have them as the central hero. I mean, they're doing it. Naughty Dog are doing it with Uncharted now. They've taken Nathan Drake out of it, and the next one's going to be the female protagonist, whose name I can't remember because I can't remember anything about bloody Uncharted at all. But the point is, you have an established world, you have established universe, you have established characters, you have everything, and it's just like, why? Why can't you just carry on with Cerberus as a villain, or a new world order trying to take over after the Reaper War, or just, you know, anything like that. You could do so much, and I thought the idea of jumping to Andromeda was to, like, give you a fresh start, and that's fine. But if you're going to do a fresh start, don't suddenly include all the same old aliens, all the same old problems, and just go, well, we're just 5 million light years away from that one over there, which ended in a way we couldn't paint ourselves out of. You know.
Well, I mean, personally speaking, I mean, I get what you're saying. I mean, I'd love to explore the characters. I just don't see any way you can do that while acknowledging every potential outcome for Mass Effect 3 as a canon one. Bearing in mind, one of the canon endings is everyone dies. What I would like to see personally, though, is I'd like them to jump now maybe 300 or 400 years in the future. So we, and I think they did this a bit in, it wasn't the Dragon Age games. I think it was the Fable ones. No. But you kind of visit places where your player character might be referenced or mentioned through deeds and stuff which happened. But, you know, no, there's enough distance there where... Is it Dragon Quest, was it?
Dragon Age, yeah. Yeah.
Dragon Age, yeah. But, you know, there's enough distance there where stuff you've done is kind of referenced and you've got that familiarity and you can, oh, yeah, I remember. I remember that, Sonny, back in the day. But equally, it gives you a chance now for all new characters, for the most part. Again, with the Mass Effect universe, you could still have Asari characters, some Krogan characters, characters could still be kicking about because they're long-lived enough that you can have those. And yeah, I'd like them to, you know, again, effectively acknowledge that mistakes were made. It was not different enough from Mass Effect. But we're in this universe now. You've got your Nexus set up there. So let's, you know, we've done the story of the arrival and setting up, fine. Now let's skip forward a little bit now where they're kind of branching out a little bit more, doing something a bit different, you know, again, get a bit of difference between these species now and how they were in the Milky Way, because again, they've been removed from that culture. People growing up in the Andromeda are not exposed to all the cultural influences they would be back in the Milky Way potentially. And maybe for interbreeding and stuff like that, people are a bit different and stuff. I'd like to see the Mass Effect universe do a big, effectively what Next Gen did after TOS, almost, you know, it's a big jump. It's familiar, yeah, but still different. And it just gets you out of any issues of trying to continue the story we just had with those characters. Because, like I said, for the most part, don't give a fuck.
Well, I mean, to be quite honest, I mean, if you were talking, just going back to the thing you were saying about the canon endings from 3, I mean, at the end of the day, as far as just the practicalities of a game making thing, there's only two things which really need to happen. If you have a destroy or control ending, well, if you have a destroy ending, you have no AI.
Yeah.
Right. So basically, all you do is you just have, you know, alternate, you know, characters. So you have character models which are AI, and then you have character models which are not. And the same goes for if you chose the synthesis ending, you know, which is obviously, as far as I'm concerned, the correct ending. Mm-hmm. All you've got to do is you've just got to have that overlay of green. Or even just... No, but you. What I'm trying to say is you can even just turn around and say, oh, well, you know, that faded after so many years or whatever.
It got better.
Yeah, but look, if you can turn around and say 1,000 years of plague has suddenly just been waved away by sleeping for 600 years, I think at this point, all bets are off. And then the control ending is just don't do anything. It's just that's it. You know, Shepard flew away and so the Reapers did, and they'll be back in 50,000 years. I mean, to me, the practicalities are quite minimal. It's just like, you either swap a character model or you swap the textures. And it's just, that's it. And if you make a story which doesn't involve AI characters, as in Geth and all that kind of stuff, then what's the problem? I mean, that's the thing. It's just, to me, you can make a story that just acknowledges these things in, you know, in codex. You know, it doesn't have to be, you don't have to panic about, oh, we have to show the Quarian homeworld. Well, we never saw it before until 3. And whether or not the Quarians were there or not, if they're not in the game, it's, you know, the story doesn't support it, then that's fine. It's you know what I mean? It's just, there's a massive rich universe. It's like, for example, you know, in Voyager, you never see Klingons. Well, it doesn't matter.
Yes, you do.
Well, you do. Okay, well, in which case you saw him when I wasn't around watching it. But
oh, no, no. Ron Moore did precisely one episode of Voyager, and you better believe those Citronella candles came out.
Oh, fuck. Did they come out with big red light bulbs and Vaseline on the screen?
Oh, you better believe it, mate.
Oh, shit. Anyway, all I was going to say was you can refer to these things, you can nod to them, and you can say they are there and keep the continuity going, but you don't have to have them in there if the story doesn't support them. You can just keep, you know what I mean? It's, you know,
I know what you mean. I just think if you do that, you end up with Crusade. Whereas I think if you've jumped us to Andromeda, you've done that, fine. That game's been released, whatever, it exists. We can't change the past. It's gone out there. So let's just up sticks, move down the street, and start here. I just think if you start going back to the Milky Way, I just don't think it's... I think it's going to be even less satisfying. I mean, okay, it depends on them writing a good story. They might write an amazing story, in which case, that's all good. You can do anything then. But I don't have faith in them to make whatever they do satisfying.
Well, it depends. It depends. Characters. It depends on what team gets hold of it, really, doesn't it? And how long they give.
I mean, again, we did mention earlier, there is a very fascinating article that was on Kotaku, which I'm sure Herr Medcalf will stick in the show notes.
Yes.
You have show notes now, apparently, so we'll stick those in.
Apparently, yeah.
I mean, it was quite a tortured development, it would seem, in that someone... you've seen that graph, the creative process.
Yeah.
Fuck all, fuck all, fuck all, fuck all, fuck all, fuck all, fuck all. All the work while crying, deadline. It was that, basically. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. It was Kotaku, and then now you got to put hyphens in the spaces, but it's kotaku.com/the story behind Mass Effect Andromeda's Troubled 5, and then it's got a number, which is 179588.
I'll tell you what, if you just type into Google the story behind Mass Effect Andromeda's Troubled Development,
crackling,
I think you'll find it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I think if you look up Mass Effect's Troubled 5-year of development, I mean, it is really interesting because it seems like a lot of the problems were just to do with everything being rushed because the bloody engine wasn't right.
Yeah, again, it's the remark they say that Frostbite's like a Formula One car. The stuff it does well, it does amazingly well. But the stuff it doesn't do well, it just doesn't do at all.
Yes, and you have to do it all over again.
And it seems this was an edict from up on high that you will use Frostbite.
We'll have a look at that. Have a read of that and see what you think. But I think one of the biggest problems was the ambition outstripped their ability to do it in time.
Well, I think, yeah, their ambition... I think if they had been able to... Let's say they were just using a Mass Effect 3 engine with, like, some new graphic upgrades on it, and all of that time was just story, it would have been amazing. But it wasn't. They spent most of that time doing engine work, and then by the time they got to the story, a lot of the stuff they wanted to do in story they couldn't do because the engine wouldn't know to do it anymore.
Yeah.
So, oh well, there you go. I think we should probably do, because again, he stopped knocking out in that Jeffrey's tube, and I'm getting a little worried about the lack of air holes, as I mentioned.
Yeah, I think so.
Starting to smell a bit as well.
yeah. Well, you shouldn't put him in there with Livingston the lionfish. You know he's going to run out of, you know, one of them's going to go off quick.
It's not that. It's just it smells like a pork pie.
Yeah, it smells like the floor of the IMAX cinema in Leicester Square. Okay then. Well, thank you very much for that then. It's your turn to open the box anyway, not mine.
Sorry, I can't hear you. I'm about to go on a mission somewhere and do stuff in a place.
Yes, yeah. I'm going to go check out for rocks. Okay then. Well, what did you think? What about you people? You're listening here. If you're still listening to this, then you're obviously somehow interested after the third
episode. God only knows why.
So let us know what you think. What was your final thoughts on Andromeda? Did you like it? Do you agree with Andy that it was a sort of flawed but overall good game? Or do you agree with me in saying that it was a complete pile of...
an abomination unto the Lord?
Well, not quite, because I have played games that are abominations unto the Lord, and it isn't one of them. But it's...
So this wasn't the Manos Hands of Fate of video games?
Fuck no. No, I've played games like that, and I know it's not that. It's just in terms, it's the Phantom Menace of the Mass Effect universe for me at the moment.
I'd say it's Revenge of the Sith.
Well, it's certainly not Attack of the Clones, thank fuck.
Oh God, no.
Anyway, so we'll just chat over that off air, I guess. So yeah, let us know what you thought. Leave us a comment on the Facebook page, which is facebook.com/groups/spacedocjury, or give us a chat on the Twitter feed. Though don't argue about the speed. I'm not talking about speed with anyone over Twitter again, ever.
Yeah, or he's really more of a cocaine person.
Yeah, exactly.
Know? Or smack.
Yeah, methadone.
Yeah. MDMA.
He chills you out, cools you off and loses your teeth. Anyway, yeah. So, yes, do catch up with us on Twitter, which is at SpaceDocJury. And that's it. Andy, do you want to just do a bit of pluggage?
You can catch me on the Grand Prix podcast with Elton McManus, which is at rogue2media.com. And it's entirely possible by the time this comes out, we might have done another episode of a Band of Brothers podcast. But yeah, I wouldn't hold any breaths or anything.
No, probably not. Okie dokie. Right. Well, thank you very much again for listening. Thank you, Andy. And yes, we'll catch you all next time. Until then, see you later. Tatty bye.
I should go.
You can't say that anymore. You're in the wrong.
Yes,
you're in the wrong universe.
Nah, I still say it.
No, you can't. My world beats outside our homes. Times of need, we are apart. Under stars, we are alone.
Space Doc Jury is a production of Three Angry Beards.